Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ask Me Anything session. I'm very excited to be here and welcome back on the stage my guest and the first speaker that opened it all up. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Igor Becker. Just before we went on the stage, talked with Igor, and he said that all of this is looking more and more like a TV studio, so this might as well be dinner with Igor, because in Latvia it is dinner time right now, so probably people at home are enjoying some nice meals, and you can listen to Igor, so I think it's the best combination possible, right? I just discovered that we have this weird power dynamic. I'm standing, you're sitting. I hope that that doesn't disturb you.
You want me to stand?
No.
Okay.
Please, feel relaxed, have some coffee, and
thank you very much.
We'll have a nice chat. And for this chat to happen, ladies and gentlemen, we need your questions. I have got a few questions on my side, but we really need your questions. So please write them in the Deep Tech stage feed. I've got it open right here, and that's the way we're going to have the conversation, maybe some comments, some questions, anything you would like is possible. And before we start that, we do have a survey, I believe, in my schedule. Yes. So we're going to start off with a survey. The question is up now. It doesn't have a time limit, but the question is, will the super fast development of technology at the end be a benefit for humankind? And the possible answers are yes, no, both, I have no idea, and it is just part of the inevitable evolution. That's the options you can check right now, and we will come back to that survey a little bit later on. You can maybe we can discuss the results. So you do do that survey and do write in questions in the feed below. I see that right here. So I will be your voice, dear audience, and Igor will give us wonderful answers. Igor, I would just like to kick things off. Listen to your speech with amazement, with the passion that you gave us all. So, it is an Ask Me Anything session.
Yes.
Can you dive into yourself a little bit? What brought you here? What is the thing that drives you to be this passionate and inspire others?
Yeah, of course. First of all, bon appetit if you're starting having dinner. I think a lot of people have drivers from their youth. I have too. I come from a weird upbringing, and you learn later in life, you discover your passions and maybe even your purpose, what you're really about, what gets you out of bed in the morning. For me, that is, I see so many opportunities, and life is lifelong learning. I meet at every I do around 200 conferences per year. So that means that I have like 2, 4, 6, 8 speakers per conference. I learn so much that is the most important part of my job. And I'm really passionate about how we can, for example, I see a lot of things in the world that we could still change. Mm-hmm. There is 1 billion people that have no food. There is 2 billion people overweight or obese. So I see a lot of things that we can really, really start changing now. That, of course, starts, I believe, in a human-inspired social innovation.
Sort of like a mixture of inspiration. You take inspiration from others and,
yes.
and give, yeah. give to them.
Yes.
I'm going to throw you another question. If we're speaking about children, probably many mothers, fathers, families watching this event, and they might feel, okay, maybe I didn't make it, but maybe my child can. So what could be the skills and the knowledge that you would recommend, seeing all this incredible development? What are the skills of the future that parents should invest in their children and let them loose just to grow?
It's a very important question. Thank you for that. I think there's two things. I was raised by my grandparents, old school people, which of course have come from a different world and have different morals, values, and ideas about the world. I think parents of today have that too. The most difficult thing is I'm a parent. I have a son as well and a stepdaughter. So the one and most important thing that I advise parents, don't project. Some people feel like horrible for the rest of their lives because they are a disappointment in the eyes of the parents because they didn't become a doctor or a lawyer. I also was a big disappointment because my grandparents said, well, you need to find a stable job and don't take risks and stop the entrepreneurial bullshit. But the most important skills is imagination. Most of the kids lose that. We as parents, after Walt Disney, we completely lost our imagination. So I hope that a lot of parents see that nowadays they make the joke. I hope my daughter marries a nerd. but stimulate your children to explore, to be curious, and to get out of their comfort zones, because that's where the magic really, really happens. And my son is also, he asks me sometimes ideas. I said, listen, I'm not you. You are your own individual, and the skills of the future are everything that differentiates us from robots and technology and the machines, because they will take over part of our jobs or the jobs that we have in the future. And the soft skills that we have, I call it ancient intelligence, we the people, versus artificial intelligence. The most developments for the coming 10 years in people are communication skills, soft skills, hospitality skills, skills that differentiate us from technology.
And I think that's really important, not to be replaced by technology, right?
Oh, yes, very important. And we've seen in the future, in the past, in America, for example, where they were building walls to keep Mexicans out. And I asked the media, listen, people, it's not Mexicans or other people taking the jobs. It's robots, automation, and AI. And very important, and our huge responsibility for the coming 20, 30 years is how do we educate the people for the future, the next level, and how can we help those people to stay relevant and part of, and I would say let the robots do the heavy labor and the stupid work and repetitive work, and we as people can work on mindfulness, next level skills, social interaction, hospitality. So that's where I see the future of work and the future of a younger generation.
We have a question from our audience here. I think it's actually a startup that's gonna participate in the startup competition, Code It.
Okay.
So their representative is sending in a question. He understands you had a rough path before that. He wants to find out more. What was the thing that made you not stop, that made you not quit, and that got you on this path that you are right now on, and this amazing journey? But there had to be something, I don't know, emotion, skill, belief, maybe it was the environment. What was the thing for you that kept you pushing forward?
Wow, it's a very good question. Persistence is very important. Of course, I was called, not my invention, I liked it though, a misfit. I really...
You took a fuel from that, the being called a misfit?
No, but yeah, maybe, because misfits from an old Steve Jobs commercial are the rebels, the crazy ones, the people that I was kicked out of professional football, which was my own fault. No sad stories about how I hurt my knee. I had a different mentality, which was not... I was already expelled from university. Elon Musk is also saying, we all want to go to universities, but we also need smart entrepreneurial people that can act upon things that are not in a book, especially the future. It's no science, there are no books, there is no education on the future. And I think that failure is part of that. And as a misfit, I studied transformation, but I lived it. And the moment that people say, this is incredibly impossible, Igor, a lot of my predictions are far out. The line between being a complete and utter idiot and a radical visionary is really, really thin. But I get really motivated when people say it's impossible. That's the warming up for me. And I hope for a lot of people that you can also... it's difficult for us because society has opinions and we all have rules and we all have these stereotypes that we project on us. I see a young generation of kids who are becoming entrepreneurs, influencers, the new skills, and the older generations, they have these projections and fingers and judgmental ideas. Please, it's your life, live it your way. Really, really important.
Thank you for that question. Please do send in your questions. I've got a bunch of mine, so I'm going to ask them if you don't. Let's talk a little about more about the imagination part. I caught on to that one, and you said that imagination at one point can stop, and it might be killed by others. So what are the things that kills imagination? What are the things that maybe parents should watch out for? Is it the whole system, like going to school, then earning money, getting a house, getting married? Is the structure the one that kills, or are there other things as well?
No, again, a very good question. I think that a lot of kids, I've been investigating that a lot, speaking to all kind of smart people in the field of psychology and sociology. Where do we lose our imagination? Because we learn kids to dream. Walt Disney, and you can explore, it's nice. At some point in life, we become very serious. We say, no, don't do that, don't risk averse, don't dream, just be realistic. It's the system, it's the schools. We have a sort of invented a system where you need to color within the lines. Yeah? I think it's not even outside the comfort zone or out of the box. No box needed. You need to be able to dream and think. That's where creation, invention comes from. We saw a lot of examples today. Mm. And society is making us really back into the box. And when I speak to adults, I happen to know that mostly 2%, only 2% of the people has the ability to be really think free. And to say, well, I'm going to chase my dreams and make the impossible possible. And that is what I advise to a lot of people. I've been speaking about the coming 30 years. Society will change more than the last 300 years. So if we can keep that imagination, the non-linear minds are the people of the future. And if you can imagine your future, you can create it. Mm. And that is really important. And I hope and I think and I feel that society should really stimulate the crazy ones, the misfits, and the people that can, well, take us to next levels.
Mm. I love the connection we're having here. It's wonderful speaking to a human, not to a screen for a while.
Screen.
Because you actually stepped onto the next question that I wanted to ask you. In your presentation, you mentioned the exponential brain.
Yes.
And I was just wondering, what are the characteristics of one? Let's deconstruct it so that maybe people can start understanding what they need to learn.
Yeah.
Have some coffee.
Cheers.
What are the things they need to look out for or develop so that they keep up with this rapid development in the next 30 years?
Yeah. My biggest challenge there is to take C-level, senior people with I had some weird questions in my life. I needed some mentors and senseis, older, experienced men and women that helped me. And I, for example, asked them, I'm young, I have these crazy ideas, but people are not listening, they're laughing because I'm young, I'm not really senior yet. Yeah, now it's easy. I lost my hair, I have a gray beard. but before that, they always say, well, who are you? You're young, you don't know. That is how we keep crazy or smart people down, because you're not senior yet. The sense I told me, Igor, there's one solution for that. Wait for 20 more years until you have earned your speaking rights and your stripes. I thought, wow. I don't have patience for that. I said, what else is there that I can do? They said, make 3, 4, 5 exits. Because if you can prove that your crazy brain is making money, or that you can start up and sell businesses. And so the same as we heard Rocket Rick tell, like the Bezos and the Musk, I needed a few exits to earn speaking rights. I wanted to speak about the future and the trends and the possibilities out there. And somewhere in this world, older generations, they have the rights to say, well, I'm a forced type, and so if you want to show your IDs, you will bounce into that. It's like getting your first job. If you're applying for your first job, you will probably hear 20 times, yeah, but you don't have really don't have work experience. And in the past, when I was applying for work, I said, yeah, if you all keep saying that, I will never find a job. So you keep pushing the boundaries. And also, sometimes you have to be radical. You have to be able to fail and to make mistakes. That's where you learn a lot. I make a lot of mistakes. My investments go wrong. I made 5 exits myself. I reinvested that money. But people only see the shine. no, it's not always the shine. It's the risk of people say entrepreneurship is like freedom. No, forget about it. Freedom. If you're a real entrepreneur, you work 120 hours a week. I know that new generations want it fast and instant. I want to be an influencer and I want to have 10 million followers and be a millionaire tomorrow. Or I want to surf in Bali 6 months per year. And it's all fine. Do what fits you best. But think that a lot of things, building success takes time. Mm-hmm. And you need persistence and you need to have a DNA that is ready to fail, get up again, fall again, flat on your mouth. Like top sports mentality, it's hard.
Mm-hmm. By the way, compliments on the beard. You look like straight out of the superhero movie. So good.
You know what my friends say? There. Oh, is Gandalf going on tour again?
Excellent. Let's take a look at the survey. The question was, will the super fast development of technology at the end be a benefit for humankind, the super fast growth? So 50% is saying yes. 21% is saying both. It could be and it could be not. They're not sure. And 29% are saying it's just part of the inevitable evolution. So is this all so inevitable and we're this growth that you said, is it already like promised? Will it happen? Or are there still obstacles that we need to face in order for these next 30 years to have this exploding development for the world?
No, very important. Older generations need to be able to adapt to the future, keep stretching their non-linear minds. That's what it's all about. The only thing that I do is stretching mindsets so that you are able to sort of look differently at the same world. What will the trends do to you? And the most important thing, if you don't have that mindset, you can also not, if you cannot imagine your future, you're out. And the most important thing to me for the coming 30 years, exponential means faster than ever before. I worry about one thing, really, really worry. I've been speaking about it for 20 years. Technology, morals, values. What is the global set of values? You see that in this pandemic, you will see it again and again. What are the morals, the values, the ethics, and the laws and the treaties in place to guide technology in the way that we want it? If we apply it to social crediting apps and into totalitarian regimes, technology will kill all democracies on this planet. If we use technology in the right ways to the future, we will have prosperity, we can solve and cure diseases, help people with education, and we can make the world a fairer and better place. And this is all about the vision. What future do we want? How will we create it? And what do we do now? I mean, we've seen the Zuckerberg hearings. Lawmakers and policymakers, they should hire trend watchers and futurists way more. I'm in a lot of Hollywood think tanks. You know what the mistakes is that we make predicting the future in sci-fi movies? We are wrong in timing. If we say it will happen in 2045, and everybody says, yeah, sci-fi, it happens 10 or 15 years sooner than we all, it's now going so fast. That means if we don't shape the world now in laws and ethics, we will destroy everything that we worked for so hard. And I want to stress one thing, I am a true technology believer, but human-inspired social innovation. I think that it's really important that we don't underestimate ancient intelligence. AI is fantastic and it can do it all and it will grow in 2050, 2100, it will do certain things, but we underestimate that we as human beings, our body, our minds, we are the most incredible and smart computers on the planet, and don't underestimate ancient intelligence yet. Before robots can do that, it might not even be in this century.
Because that's what fascinates me. And you said, also mentioned the people wanting that maybe Elon Musk has and Steve Jobs had and everybody right now. But I think we're actually forgetting that this ancient knowledge is what brought us here. Okay, the world is not perfect. But we are here. We're talking to people over 41 countries right now, looking into the camera. it's a great world, and it was built on this knowledge. So I think we should not lose that knowledge, right?
No, it's very important. And there I see roles and responsibility of people that are independent, authorities, that they speak about the future without commercial benefits. You can offer me any kind of money. I'm not an influencer, I'm an influencer. I want to speak about ethics, morals, and values without commercial. And I see that a lot of media and also big parties and movements are not giving us the 360 scope of what's really happening. For example, some institutes or technology centers say, okay, simple comparison, a robot can do 500 injections per hour, so robots are smarter than nurses, and we need to replace nurses by robots. No. The robots can do the injections much faster than the nurses, yes, but the nurses have 20 other skill sets that patients really need. Let's not make the mistake that we carve out the human, social, and all other skills, empathy, social, communicative skills that we really need. So we need to be careful in comparing and saying, well, humans need to be out because robots can do it better. I like people that say robots can do the injections much better. But this is the human skills. So carving out the nurses, maybe they don't do injections anymore, and they can focus more on the patients. I believe in man with machine and not man versus machine. That would be really stupid. Some people also ask me something that you asked before. Is it good or bad? Depends on how you look at it. No, the robots shouldn't take all our work because we will all be unemployed. On the other hand, in mindfulness and growth and human beings, do we want unemployed or low-skilled people to do the same stupid repetitive work for 40 years? Why not outsource that to the robots, educate and train those people, and give you more meaningfulness in life? But what is the set of global goals that we want? And I really think that lawmakers, governments, and makers of the futures lack the future vision, where it's going, and how. I talked about autonomous cars, beautiful. I would like to be in the back, and I don't know, being in a metaverse or a virtual world, and not driving. But if we lose 200 million jobs in the transport and mobility industry, and those people are unemployed at home, we need to create the future how we want it to be.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me remind you, we have on our stage the very distinguished Igor Bruker. He's a speaker, publicist, entrepreneur, and an investor. And thank you for your questions that you're sending in right now. People are opening up finally. So yeah, the last 8 minutes, we're going to shoot through them. So this first one comes from Santa. I think she's giving you a compliment and asking you, how are you keeping your brain so healthy and in great shape? Vitamins, exercising, reading, what's your secret?
My mindset? That's most important. We tend to spend a lot of time in looking cool on social media. I don't care about that at all. I sometimes have the power to be disliked. If you don't like me, get the hell out. In a world of vanity metrics and likes, we've been mistaking. We go to the gym. That's really important. But what do we do to work on our mindset? Progress, personal development. I eat clean, I go to the gym, but I train my mind, and I make sure that I become a better person on the inside, because I really think long term, and that's really important. And I'm really surprised, the most powerful thing I have is my mind. And a lot of older people that are leading big companies, if you are open-minded, I'm a marketer, and I've always learned this, I don't care about me, I care about my target audiences. And if I can add meaningfulness to your lives, and I will never say, yeah, but I don't like gaming, it's stupid, who am I? So open mind and keeping a non-judgmental look at this as opportunities is the greatest gift. Even if it will be look at Stephen Hawking in a wheelchair, whatever. He was one of the greatest minds on this planet. And if you train your mind and invest in that, you can do that until you're 110 years old.
What's your favorite book?
I think one of the Yuval Noah Harari series. And for me, that is the 21st lessons for the 21st century.
Okay, take that down. Julian is asking, if Igor could choose a superpower, what power would it be and why?
I'm very satisfied with the superpowers that I have. energy and honesty and authenticity. I've been arrested, locked up, and brought down by countries because I tend to speak the honest truth, which is very difficult for speakers, journalists, and writers. I have a cause and a mission that is much greater than me. I really admire the Mandelas and the Malalas. So I would like to have the superpower of becoming more fearless and doing even greater things for society. I looked my son in the eye and I said once, if dad keeps continuing his mission, he might not be home one day. Because in some countries, it's very dangerous to speak your mind. And becoming completely fearless would be the superpower that I... and a bit of the NASA space technology, a cyborg. My eyes are very bad, so I want to have my eyes chipped that I can see like an eagle. Yeah, technology is going to help us a little bit in the future, I think.
Igor, you really surprised me. I thought you were going to say fly or super strength or laser vision, fearlessness. That's a superpower.
Yeah.
Mark that down. Excellent. I hope, Julian, you got your answer to your question. Let me shoot in a question from my side. What is the most disruptive technology that exists right now? Maybe it doesn't have to be super popular now, but what is the disruptive technology that's about to change everything? Is it cryptocurrency? That's a trend right now. I don't know if you want to step into that field. We're not financial advisors, okay?
No, but I get the question a lot. Yeah. I believe that most of our systems, financial, political, educational, were built for the 20th century. And that is like running Windows 3.0 or iOS 3.0. We need to upgrade all our systems to the next century. Blockchain would be logical, transparent, the whole value chain. NFT for artists is something that I would really look at. People ask me, should I invest in crypto? That is a speculation or another question. 3D printing I show today, which could be massive, changing entire industries, giving us organs that we need. But I really look at, that is my, I invested almost all of my money in startups that are hopefully going to do good for the world, but they will never be profitable. So I'm working a lot with super serial entrepreneurs and social innovators who have the money to spend it on doing good. The ROI is a cleaner, brighter planet, feed the people, educate them. And I think that is for me. I've been working a lot with making the impossible possible. I've been at conferences with Richard Branson, who I admired, a rock star, serial entrepreneur. And I said, listen, if we can apply space, triple play, I call it, the new triple play, space and satellites for humanity. We can monitor deforestation on land. We can monitor the oceans, coral reefs and overfishing. And now the skies can protect the earth and the seas. And that is really beautiful ways of applying predictive data and scientific proof to people that sometimes don't speak the truth or have commercial ideas to say, no, it's not true. Data never lies. People do. So, but these new opportunities to shape and change the world, yeah, it's going to be massive. But under the hood of Industry 4.0, there will be 20, 30, 40 exponential technologies, which would all in their own ways disrupt the world, good or bad.
Mm-hmm. Igor, what is the greatest benefit from this pandemic era that we're still living in? Hopefully it's going to end soon. What is the greatest benefit that's going to come out of this past year or so?
Well, I think on long term for humanity and society, it's pushing and stressing the importance for now and for the future to make these set of ethics and values, to make sure that we are transparent. We need to restore trust, politics, leaderships with the people. I already said technology in the right hands, it's what it's all about. And I think that digital transformation on steroids is here to stay. I don't know if that's good or not, but that's a fact of life, I think. Because even people, the laggards, people that would never go online or digital, we're all online now, and digital is the world. And so I hope that this pandemic will also give us a set of ethics that will help us. But I've also seen things that really worry me. totalitarian regimes? Are we applying technology to do good or to control and humanity? Mm-hmm. And I'm really worried about that, because that's again a thing about ethics and what do we want?
With all this surveillance, cameras and everything, we're seeing China developing their big system of social points.
Social credit systems.
Yeah. Is privacy dead?
No, people are dead because we make those decisions. And if we want to apply technology to control people, chip you and give you a passport and say if you say something bad, you can. 23 million people in China cannot leave the country because of a social crediting system. Who decides that? We have to be, I think, very careful that we don't play for God with technology and apply those to make the world really better.
Mm-hmm. Let's end this up in a beautiful way. Igor, what are your values in life?
The most important things for me as a person is that I was raised by grandparents who lived through World War II. Honesty, the audacity to speak the truth, voice of reason, see the world as a bigger place than myself, my ego, my success. It's important. But what do you do with the brain power and the skills that you have? You can have 20 Bentleys or you can invest in a social startup. And my role is that I really want to help social entrepreneurship, VCs and other people, smart entrepreneurs, to invest money in those startups. Nice if you're profitable, even better if you can do people, planet, profit.
Mm-hmm. Where can people follow you online? How can people see some more of your speeches, etc.?
Should I give a warning sign or no? No explicit content inside. Well, if you go to my, I'm at Igor Beuker at almost every social channel or YouTube or Twitter or Insta, or I'm sometimes on TikTok, but that is exploring.
Excellent. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause to our excellent guest right here. He's a speaker, publicist, entrepreneur, and an investor, Igor Beuker.
Thank you very much.